coming your way. A blessing is coming your way. And your blessing will bless.
Redemption Christian Center of Trinidad and Tobago presents Light in the Word with Bishop Dr. Victor Gill.
Hallelujah. At this time, we'd like to welcome our pastor, Pastor Victor Gill, as he brings the Word of God to us this morning. Put your hands together for him as he comes.
Assuredly, I say to you, among those born of women, there has not risen one greater than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Today I want to share with you on the subject, the high calling of the church. The high calling of the church. As Christians, if we are going to resist temptation and overcome the trials of this life, we must first understand what is our high calling in Christ. When you understand the value of what you have in Christ, then you would be motivated to defend your position regardless of the circumstances. When you know the value of a thing or an institution, you will tend to treat it according to the value you ascribe to it. And therefore, it is very important that we understand what we have in Christ, the high calling we have in Christ, and the value that is placed on that by God, by the revelation of Scripture. When you know who you are in Christ, when you know who you are as a Christian, then you will appreciate the body of Christ and what it means to be a part of it. Jesus said in the text, in verse 11, he said, "Assuredly I say unto you, among those born of women, there has not arisen one greater than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." That's a very profound statement. Jesus said, "Assuredly I say to you, among those born of women, there has not risen one greater than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John." Jesus said, John is greater than Noah, Enoch, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all the patriarchs. He's greater than David, Solomon, Nebuchadnezzar, Ahasuerus, Cyrus, Artaxerxes. He is greater than religious kings and secular kings. He said, John the Baptist, my forerunner, God's forerunner. Oh, let me preach this thing in here. God's messenger, the one who goes before him to prepare the way, the one who will go and say, hey, the Messiah is going to be manifested in flesh. He is among us, but I will point him out to you. That man who will baptize God to institute and inaugurate a new kingdom and a new era, that man is greater than everybody that went before, kings who sat on thrones and had thousands attending them. But now, all those who are born again, all those who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior and has become Christians, the least among them, the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John. Oh Lord, somebody should be shouting. Somebody should be saying, Lord, Pastor, is that true? You should be running around the church. Across there in the balcony, do you hear what I said? You are great. I said, you are great. I said, you are great. Clap yourself. And it took somebody like Jesus to say it. If anyone else had said that, we could have questioned it. But God himself said, you are the greatest. Compared to the Old Testament, nobody is greater than you. Oh, we need to know this in these end times. We need to know what we are defending when the devil comes to your back door, or he comes to your front door, or he comes to your window, or he comes to your ears and whisper and tell you to go and fool around with the daughters of darkness. Or he tell you, look, the lotto reached 7.5. I don't know how much it is now, but the last part I heard was 7.5 million. Go and buy a ticket. Go and take a chance. When the devil come and tempt you, they tell you, go back in the carnival and jump up. I want to tell you, you got to know who you are. If you're going to overcome temptation, if you're going to overcome the flesh, if you're going to overcome the devil is telling you to lie, because the devil have you backed up in a corner. And the devil is saying, if you don't do what I tell you, you ain't going to get this and you ain't going to get that. But if you know the turf you are defending, if you know who you are, if you know how you are flying, if you know what you are carrying, beloved, you are carrying God. You have become his temple. He is in you and you are in him. You are now part of the church, part of the bride of Christ, part of the body of Christ. It doesn't matter who your father was, who your mother was. Nobody can lift you to this position. The government can't lift you. Your organization can't lift you. Nobody can lift you to this position. God said he has lifted you. And if God said it, believe it. If God said it, accept it. If God said it, rejoice. If God said it, get happy. If God said it, don't be discouraged. If God said it, stop complaining. If God said it, don't look down. Look up, glory be to God. If God said it, square your shoulder. Have a new attitude. Have a different attitude. You are great. Say yes. Let me read it again. Assuredly I say unto you, among those born of women, there has not risen one greater than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater. Is greater than he. And you tell me I will backslide. You tell me I will not love Jesus. You tell me I will complain because I don't get bread on time or water on time. People make a big thing over saints today and who's a saint, and you have to qualify big times to become a saint. But I want to show you, the Bible said in Romans 1 and verse 7 that the saints are called, the believers are called saints. Put it up on the board. Notice in the King James you will see to be in italics. Here you have it in brackets because those words are not in the Bible. You understand? The reading is this: to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called saints. They put those words in bracket because they say, this is how we think it should read, but it's not in the Bible. Because even the translators found it difficult to understand because of the Catholic influence at the time the King James Version was translated around the 17th century. Are you there with me, somebody? But saints were particular people. Look also at 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 2. Sanctified in Christ Jesus, called what? Saints. To be is not in the original text. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 9 through 11 said, do you not know that your unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But you were washed. But you were washed. But you were washed. But you were sanctified or made a saint, made holy. But you were justified, declared righteous in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. You are not who you were. You are not, listen to me carefully, you are not who you used to be. You have been sanctified. You have been purchased with the precious blood of Jesus, Brother Martin. And now you're a child of God. That's your identity. Ephesians chapter 2, 11 through 13. Therefore remember that you once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called circumcision, by which is called a circumcision made with flesh by hands. That at that time you were without Christ and being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ, you who were once far off have been made near by the blood of Christ. There are three kinds of people in the world, I've been telling you. Jews, Gentiles, and the church. But only Jews and the church have covenant with God. We were once Gentiles. But when we received Christ, Gentiles means the nations. We had no hope. We had no covenant. We were without God. But when you receive Jesus Christ, something changed. All of a sudden now, you have covenant with God. The reason why God will defend Israel right down to the end of the world and even bring them back into the land as he prophesied is because he has a covenant with them. And do you know that you have a covenant with God? And that covenant entails that he will never leave you nor forsake you even to the end of the age. Paul said, trouble of this world, they are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed. Some of us go through things because God is teaching us, you know. He's teaching you, don't go there. Don't do that. Trust me. Walk with me. Follow me. Paul said to the Ephesian saints, he said, I pray for you that you will be able to comprehend with the saints what is the width and the length and the depth and the height, Ephesians 3, 18 and 19. He said, in this thing, this love of God, it have width, it have length, it has depth, it has height, and I want you to be able to comprehend it. And he was just setting them up. Because in the next verse, he said, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, or which is beyond knowledge, to know the love of Christ that cannot be known, to know the love that cannot be known intellectually, because it's beyond mental comprehension. If you were to put the love of God in numbers, there's no mathematical number. In 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 2 and 3, he says, do you not know that the saints will judge the world? The other day I ended up in court because I parked on the wrong side of the road. But I went before the judge. And the judge herself was looking irritable and tired and looking at her watch. So when my turn come, I'm wondering what to say. Your Honor, I heard a guy say, Your Worship. I said, Lord, I want to show respect because they don't tell me how much money. She will charge you 2,000 something because look how long it is and all of that. But I went up. I put on my best behavior. I said, Your Honor. She said, all right, $200. Come on, somebody. You know, you look at the judge there up on a chair with all that power and she's rebuking even the prosecutor who is the police. I feel embarrassed for him. But you know, you look at it and say, I might never be a judge. I might never reach so high. But the Bible said the saints will judge the world. The Bible said the saints, you will judge the world and you will make the right judgment. And that it's not all. Paul went on in the next verse, verse 3, and said, don't you know that the saints will judge angels? Oh my God. Somebody say, oh my Lord. The saints will judge angels. We need to know who we are. We need to understand our high calling. Knowing who we are, there's a way for us to conduct ourselves. Knowing who we are, there's a way for us to live. Knowing who we are, there's a way for us to treat with this knowledge. How you apply yourself to the things of God. Amen. How you pray. How you study the word of God. How you fellowship. Glory be to God. How you get along with other believers. Glory be to God. Amen. You got to strive toward the unity of the saints in the church. Unity in your family. Unity and love and holiness and godliness and spirituality. You can't live your Christian life. Que sera, sera. Understand who you are. What you are going through right now does not change who you are. Amen. But as long as you believe it, that settles it. Because you have it by faith. I don't care if you don't feel it. I don't care if you don't see it. Can you believe it? Just say, I believe it. Act upon it. Live it. Say, I can't do that. I'm a prince with God. I can't do that. I'm going to judge angels. I can't do that. I'm going to judge the world. I've got to have an impeccable character. I cannot be sad over this little thing. How would God look at me moping and groping over a little flea bite in comparison to eternity with God reigning and ruling with him? Come on, somebody. Amen. In the book of Colossians again, chapter 1 and verse 10, Paul said that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work, increasing in the knowledge of God. As Christians, we must be always seeking to draw closer to the Lord. We must be always seeking to become more informed in the things of God. As Christians, we should be growing. Don't come to a point in a Christian life where you become stagnated. Move on so others could find space behind you. Romans 8:16 and 17 says, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirits that we are children of God, and if children, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. Do you know what is a joint heir? A joint heir is joint owner. I want you to hear me. A heir is one to whom an inheritance belongs. A joint heir is one who has equal ownership and claim to the inheritance. Listen to this now. The inheritance of Jesus is tremendous glory for obeying God in this world. That glory says in John 17:22, he said, that glory I give to them. Same glory. And so Paul says in Romans, confirming that, we are joint owners, joint heirs with Christ. Now I know that is mind-boggling. I know that is incomprehensible. I know that is incalculable. I know it is difficult to wrap your brain around that. But that makes it even more glorious. That is why the Bible says in 1 John 3 and verse 1, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the children of God, the sons of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because they did not know him. We are what we are because God said it. What will you exchange the glory of God for on this earth? And I think there's no better way to describe it if we just say glory, glory of heaven, glory in heaven. But glory, what could be glory for God? What could be glory for God as an inheritance? And he said, that same glory. You're not hearing me, man. What could really move God? God is God. God had all pleasure at his hand. So, God inheritance, the inheritance of the Son, has to be real great, you know. Anybody there? And the Bible said, that is your inheritance. The Bible says, walk worthy. Live as if you understand. As if you deserve. We really can't deserve. But at least try at least to show that you are cognizant. That does not matter what the multitude do. Doesn't matter how many people, whatever. Because the Bible doesn't say in the last days, broad will be the road that will lead to destruction and many will follow it. But you see, because I know who I am, I understand this thing. I feel tempted just like you. I still think women are beautiful, they are curvaceous, but something within the brain of my brain tell me, brother, listen to me, run from every appearance of evil. I don't think about how good it will feel. I think about after. Only after comes into my mind. Trust me. Only after. The morning after. Not even the morning after. The minute after. I don't want to lose my salvation. I don't want to lose this call. I don't want to lose my stride. Glory be to God. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still on one bong. Glory be to God. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost high and catch a glimpse of glory bright. Daniel said that they that be wise will shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Now that we are in this world, we are in the righteousness business. The Bible says he that winneth souls is wise. When you win souls, you turn them to God. And when you turn them to God, you turn them to Christ. And when you turn them to Christ, you turn them to righteousness. Because the Bible says, 2 Corinthians 5:21, the Bible says that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Glory be to God. So we turn many to righteousness. He that winneth souls is wise. And so Daniel says that they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament. Solomon says a man wisdom makes his face to shine. And one of these days we will shine as who we are truly are. They that be wise shall shine as the brightest of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Oh, glory be to God. So one old deacon said, he said, if you see yourself in glory, if God give you a glimpse of your future, child of God, you will bow down and worship yourself. Some of you might take off and run from yourself. You might say, look, God coming. Yeah, that's not God yet. That is you. I came to make you children of mine. I came to take you out of no purpose. Destitute, lost, given up by men. Some of you came here not because they wanted you, but because of rape or because of abuse. And you grew up in abuse. But now you are saved. Now you're a child of God. Now you are being prepared to judge the world and judge angels. Now you are God's saint. Whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord. For the Lord you'll receive a reward. Amen. I know you may not like the man you eventually got married to, but still treat him as a gentleman that Christ may be seen in you. You may not like the woman that you got married to, but you don't marry. And you got to treat her like a lady, because even though, you see, love is its own avenger. Whatever she does with your love, that's her business. But you see, you got so much overflow, and you know who you are, and you know where you are going. And you know that one day you're going to be up there reigning with God. One day you're going to know even as you are known. You say, I have enough resources. I could forgive you out of the abundance of knowing who I am. If Christ could do that for me, it's nothing for me to forgive you. Look, I'll bring some chicken for you. I feel like preaching this thing. Look, hallelujah, I'll bring some El Picos for you. Careful to go in El Picos these days. Let me choose something else. Amen. I brought Subway for you. I bring 1 foot. I bring 2 feet. Amen. Come on, because we know we are. Don't tell me you're a Christian and you're just in petty things. Come on, you're still in the dog fight. You're still acting like a ghetto rat. Come on, somebody. We got some dignity. We got some pedigree. Come on, do I have any saints in here? Listen to me, my friend. I know who I am. I believe in what God says. This joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me. This kingdom that I have, this inheritance that I have, man did not give it to me. The people's partnership didn't give it to me. And they can't fire me. Say yes. It's important that we know what we have. That is why you should obey God when he calls you. Say, Lord, you know, I'm trying to do this. I'm trying to do that. I'm trying to do that. Hey, I call you. You do what I say. I am God. Hallelujah. I'm going to take you out of this world very soon. The darker it gets, the more trouble appears in the world. Know that the time is closer. So what is tribulation for the world is the witness of glory for you. Rejoice, Jesus said. When you see all these things that begin to happen, look up. Jesus said in John 3 and verse 21, to him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me in my throne. As I also overcame and sat down with my Father in his throne. To him who overcome. Why would Jesus say overcome if you didn't know you'll face challenges? Some of the things you are going through has been appointed to try you because of the height you are called to. Your trial may not be mine, and I'm not sure you will want mine. Because when I got mine, I saw death in the eyes. But God. When I got mine, I almost went mad. You know what kept me? God kept me. So if God kept me, God can keep you. Because it's not a depth of the trial, but a mighty God who is with us. Glory be to God. He said, he that overcomes will sit with me in my throne. As I overcame and sat with my Father in his throne. Now let me tell you, that throne doesn't necessarily refer to a literal throne, although it may be, but even a literal throne is just a representation of authority. So what he's saying, if you overcome, you will enjoy all what my throne signifies.
Thank you for tuning in to Light in the Word, a production of Redemption Christian Center. We have been receiving calls from across the Caribbean, from Jamaica, Barbados, St. Vincent, St. Lucia, even right here in Trinidad and Tobago. And we thank you for calling. We thank you for tuning in. Today, if you are not a Christian, this is the most important decision that you can ever make, the decision to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, to prepare for eternity. The Bible tells us that there is a heaven and there is a hell. And God loves you. He sent his son Jesus Christ to die for you. And if you want to receive him today as your Lord and Savior, join me in this short prayer. Allow me to pray for you. Say this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, today I thank you for your word. I thank you for dying for me on the cross. I repent of my sins. And I receive you today into my heart as my Savior and Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Amen. Friend, if you said that prayer, I want you to know, based on the word of God, if you said it and you mean it and you believe it, the word of God says, as many as receive him, to them we give power to become the sons of God. The Bible says, every man in Christ is a new creature. That means you are born again. And I want to encourage you to find a good Bible, believe it, Pentecostal church, and continue to be fed and nurtured. Probably you heard this word and you're a Christian. You are strayed from the Lord. I want to encourage you to come back to the Lord. And you know, repent, live holy, because he's coming for our church without spot and wrinkles. Whatever you are going through, probably you are sick in your home. I want to say a word of prayer for you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for all our listeners, those that are lost, those that are backslidden, and those that have made a decision to serve you today. Those that are sick, I pray for them. In the name of Jesus, I pray that you will save, you will heal, you will restore, you will deliver. You are sick, touch your body, and I command healing in the name of Jesus. I want to thank you again for listening. Until we meet again next time on this station, God bless you. Amen.
If you have a why to live, you can endure almost any harm.